let's be honest. Just like last week, how many of you have heard this entire chapter preached on in church? We tend to shuffle Revelation kind of like under the, unless we're like, premillennialists or fundamentalists, we tend to shuffle Revelation under the mat and just not deal with it because it's kind of some freaky, trippy stuff. Like either John was seriously on some drugs, which I don't think they had necessarily invented some of those drugs. They may have had some, who knows. The ancient world was inventive too. Or he was seriously psychotic. But either way, we're just not going to deal with this stuff, right? It's crazy. This is the stuff horror movies are made of. Back during the Protestant Reformation, the Reformers charged the Roman Catholic Church as idolaters. Does anybody know why? Awesome. Well, here's why. Because the Roman Catholic Church venerates Mary in such a way that she appears almost like a goddess, does she not? We pray to Mary. Mary intercedes for us. Mary's seen holding a scepter or holding Jesus who's holding a scepter. And she has a crown on her head. She's named the Queen of Heaven, Mother of God. Often referred to as Mother of God, which in Greek is Theotokos, and Mater Dei in Latin, Mother of God in English. Now, why do you think she's called Mother of God by the Roman Catholics?
The Trinity.
The Trinity? Yep.
Trilogy
too, that works.
Yeah, that's all that.
If John didn't come in and write the fourth gospel, it would have been a trilogy, but... the Trinity, right? Jesus is the second part of the Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Well, if Jesus is truly divine, truly God, and truly human, and Mary gave birth to Jesus, then that makes Mary the mother of God, right? In Orthodox Christianity, Jesus is understood to be God incarnate, meaning God in the flesh. And of course, Mary gave birth to that incarnation of God. The Reformers, on the other hand, thought that this was not biblically supported, that the Roman Catholics had just made this stuff up. But they aren't entirely truthful in that understanding. The Protestants kind of got this wrong. You see, for tonight, we have just read the chapter in the Bible that does support such a view of Mary. This woman, this celestial woman who's got the moon at her feet and the stars crowning her head. Such an image as Mary, Mother of God, with the divine goddess-like woman that she appears to be, at least in Revelation chapter 12. Of course, the Reformers weren't ignorant to this verse. It's just that they interpreted it differently. They would have stated that this passage does not refer to Mary, but to Israel, with the 12 stars above the head representing the 12 tribes of Israel, out of whom would come the Messiah. Thus, the woman is representative of Israel, the mother of the Messiah, from whom the Messiah would come. But in this debate, we really lose sight of the big picture. And I'm all about the big picture. Any of you who plan anything with me know I'm all about the big picture. I've got these great big ideas, but the little itty-bitty details sometimes fall by the wayside, you know? I'm all about the big picture. But the big picture is important. First, this woman can rightly be interpreted in both ways, with the latter being the big picture understanding of who the woman is, the latter being the woman as Israel with the 12 stars equaling the 12 tribes. That's the big picture, that from Israel, the chosen people of God, comes the Messiah, the Savior of the world. But the woman is not the big picture overall. For there is a lot of other things going on in this chapter, is there not? In fact, the woman is just a player in what seems to be a rather action-packed act going on here. The woman is a mere blip in time, or at least the birth of the son is certainly a blip in time, and the woman maybe a couple of blips in time. What we have going on here is the following. First off, we have a cosmological myth which explains how evil entered into creation, into the world. We all, from time immemorial, have scratched our heads and saying, well, God is good and God created everything and everything was good at creation. Has anybody looked around the world lately? It ain't so great. First off, we live and then we die, and that's not such a great thing. But what makes matters worse is we don't just die naturally. We have to kill each other and backstab and blow people up and you know, rape people and molest kids. And I mean, just take the front page of the paper today and you'll see that this is not the ideal picture-perfect good creation that supposedly God created. Where did that go? Where did that go? If God's good and God created everything good, how can evil enter the world? Well, God didn't enter into the world. Somebody else did. That dragon, that devil, that Satan. So this is a cosmological myth that explains how evil entered the world. It's not meant to be taken literally. Here's a secret when it comes to interpreting the Bible, by the way. Not everything is literal. No, not everything. Some of it, yes. But some of it, no. For instance, there is a psalm that says, oh, happy is the one who smashes their baby's heads on stones. Don't take that literally, please. That's not a happy, joyous occasion. But if we understand the context of that psalm, it makes sense because that had just happened to the Israelites' babies. And they were mourning the loss of their babies and the loss of their land. And they were pouring out of their soul their anger and their fierce rage and their wanting to get vengeance on the ones who had done. Understandable when you know the context, but not to be taken literally. So we have a cosmological myth that explains how evil entered the world. The dragon warring with God in the heavens, but being defeated by God's armies, is kicked out of the heavens. And falls. The dragon falls. The dragon representing Satan falls to earth and begins to attack God's creation and in particular God's people, God's chosen people, represented by the woman. Those attacks kept coming. And the dragon even tried to kill God's chosen Messiah. And just in case you didn't get this already, the dragon is trying to kill and destroy us too. And will try to do so until the end of time. There's just one problem for the dragon. There's just one problem for Satan. And that is namely that God wins. We have the end of the story before the end came. I know, it's a spoiler alert, right? God wins in the end. In the end, God wins. In the end, love. Right? God is love. Love wins. What this means is that no matter what Satan tries to do to us, no matter what Satan tries to do in general, God has won this war. Good triumphs over evil. That is the big picture. We get into these little minuscule theological debates as to who the woman is in Revelation 12, and we miss the larger picture. Who cares who the woman is in Revelation 12? The point of the story is that this woman is being attacked by Satan, but the dragon, Satan, does not win. No matter how hard the dragon pursues this woman, it fails. That's the big picture. So my question for you is simple. Do you believe this? Do you believe the big picture that presents to us. I mean, it's easy to look around the world and believe the end of about sin and needing grace and all of that, but do you believe the big picture? That in the end, God wins. In the end, love wins. When I turn on the news, especially this year during this political brouhaha that's stirring up every day, I question how much we truly believe it. Not just us here, but the world in general. Look how cynical we've become. Look how distrustful we as a people have become. Look how unwilling to work with others regardless of what they think and how different or same the same they might be with us. It's like, I was just explaining this to somebody online. You know, somebody said, which would you rather be? In a group that all thinks alike, but you have a hard time getting people to come and attend and be a part of community? Or in a community where everybody thinks differently and doesn't necessarily agree with one another, but everybody comes and is active? I said, I'd far rather the latter. Not because they're active. I mean, obviously I want them active. But I would far rather the latter because, quite frankly, people who all believe in the same thing, sing Kumbaya and skip down the YBR, you know, the Yellow Brick Road together, they're boring. And people who try to claim that everybody gets along and everybody agrees in our community, any community that claims that are either naive, lying, or there are cults, stay clear away. Right? Like, there is no community that agrees on everything together, that thinks alike, that looks alike, that acts alike. We have lost the ability to come together and to be different among one another, but still love, because we believe that love wins in the end. We've lost that ability. If you are voting for Trump this year, good, vote for Trump. If you're not, great, don't. If you're not voting for either one, God bless you. As you can see, I don't do politics well from up here, and I don't. I'm overtly not, I mean, we all have our political mindsets, right? But I don't preach politics from the pulpit, and I try not to preach it for my life because I don't know. You know, I've not been happy with one vote I've made my entire life. And I doubt I will be if I vote this time around. Keyword, if. But the point is, those things are the small details. The big picture is, we are all God's children, created in the image of God, created to be like God, created to live in love, created to be a big picture people. Do you believe that? Do you believe that? It's so easy to be cynical in this world. But that cynicism, my friends, is the dragon's doing. The cynicism is Satan. The cynicism is the devil. Now, do not go out of here and say, Pastor Todd preached that Trump is the devil, or Pastor Todd preached that Hillary is the devil. That's not what I said. It's on record, on the camera. I did not say that. I said,
I heard you.
Cynicism is the devil's doing. Cynicism. God is calling us to be a big picture people. And to be a people that represent the big picture of love winning. But in order to do that, we need to actually live it. That's the challenge. We need to live it. Let us do so. Amen. Yeah. Gracious and loving God, you are a God of the big picture. But a God who does not neglect the minor details. Oh, if we could be the same way. Lord, help us to see the big picture. Help us to be a people who believe that love wins. people that believe it so much that we live it. Even when we're cursing people out in our hearts, we're praying to you for help in loving them instead of cursing them. Lord, you know we're not going to do this perfectly. But that we try, that we strive to do it, that we pick ourselves up when we fall down, or better yet, that we allow you to pick us up when we fall down, and that we live in such humility is all you ask of us. Use us as your servants in this world. Keep us from being sinners. Keep us from being cynical and use us to bring about transformation and love winning in this world. Pray these things in Jesus' name.